problem. Lovely to see you. And it's lovely to see you all this morning. We have some little treats today, and we welcome back an old friend, Rupert Abbott, and he'll continue our prayer-themed services with Epaphras, Labouring in Prayer. We've got Mike and Mandy, and Sue is going to sing us a new, for us, composition. And Sue Teasdale, is going to be bringing a powerful, prayerful reflection on peace, which we all need to focus on these very troubled, war-torn times. And we thank Michael for his work on the tech desk. And what day is it today?
Sunday.
Yeah. So all our ladies will be receiving a little treat, little gift towards the end of the service. So let's get underway. Ephesians 5 verse 19 says, "Speak to one another with words of psalms, hymns, and sacred songs. Sing hymns and psalms to the Lord with praise in your hearts."
Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away.
Come have your way among us. sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
You came from
reading from Colossians 1:3-8 and then Colossians 4:12-13. We always give thanks to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you, for we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of your love for all God's people. When the true message, the good news, first came to you, you heard about the hope it offers. So your faith and love are based on what you hope for, which is kept safe for you in heaven. The gospel keeps bringing blessings and is spreading throughout the world, just as it has among you ever since the day you first heard about the grace of God and came to know it as it really is. You learnt of God's grace from Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who is Christ's faithful worker on our behalf. He has told us of the love that the Spirit has given you. Greetings from Epaphras, another member of your group and a servant of Christ Jesus. He always prays fervently for you, asking God to make you stand firm as mature and fully convinced Christians in complete obedience to God's will. I can personally testify to his hard work for you and for the people in Laodicea and Hierapolis. That's the word of the Lord. Praise be to God. Rupert. As Rupert comes to speak to us, we'll just pray. Lord, we pray for Rupert. Bless him and bless us as we open our ears and hearts as he brings your word. Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning, everyone.
Morning.
So this is part of a series on prayer, and I've been asked to focus particularly on two verses in Colossians chapter 4, which we've just had read, and I thought for a bit of context we would give some from chapter 1 as well. But first of all, as an introduction, I thought I'd say something on epitaphs. What you put on a tombstone about somebody's life. So here's a few. Can you read that one there? The family name is Spanx. And this tombstone reads, Arthur Spanx, his wife Catherine. So I think you get what happened. Arthur had died first, and it was just Arthur, and then his wife Catherine joined him. Here's another one. Raised four beautiful daughters with only one bathroom, and still there was love. My wife can identify with that. She was one of five girls in a semi-detached house with just one bathroom. And still there was love? Could you put that on the tombstone? And here's another one. Kay's fudge. Two squares of chocolate, two tablespoonfuls of butter, melt on a low heat, stir in one cup of milk, bring to the boil, three cups of sugar, one tablespoonful of vanilla, pinch of salt, cook to soft ball stage, pour on marble slab, cool, beat and eat. Wherever she goes, there's laughter. Mm. Well, it wasn't, I think part of the tombstone was her name and date of birth and date of death, but they wanted that on there as well. She was obviously known for her fudge. Okay, that's just a little introduction, folks. This story is about Epaphras. He's part of Paul's team, and he's the person that Paul has mentioned. And so, in order to get a bit of context around the verses that I've been able to focus on, I've been asked to focus on today, what we know about Epaphras, we read in the letter to Philemon, also in the New Testament, that Paul writes, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus. So Epaphras had been in prison with Paul. We don't know the details. We know Epaphras was under house arrest with Paul in Rome when he wrote that letter to Philemon and the letter to Colossians and Ephesians. Paul says in that first chapter that we read that he's one of you, writing to the Colossians, he's one of you. So as if he was writing to Matson Baptist Church, he's one of you, a part of you. And he describes him as a faithful minister of Christ on our behalf. That's why I put in the stuff about epitaphs to start with. If you just had to choose one or two words to say that sum up somebody, what would you say? How would you sum up your mum in one or two words on this Mothering Sunday? Paul summed up about Epaphras that he was a faithful servant of Jesus. So that's a bit about Epaphras. What about the church at Colossae? It wasn't a church that Paul had planted. We don't know that he ever visited there. But there is Colossae. There's Ephesus, where Paul preached for a long time. And that's near where Colossae is today. I don't think the Colossae that existed in Paul's time is there. But it's got mountains as a backdrop. And the Colossians had heard the gospel from Epaphras. Paul had been preaching for 3 years in Ephesus, during which time Epaphras was converted and he went home to Colossae, like somebody might have been converted in Birmingham and come back to Gloucester, to Matson, to preach to his own people, the people who knew him, where his family were, where he'd grown up, and hence the church got established in Colossae. You've learned, it says in Colossians, about God's grace from Epaphras. Now that word for learn in Greek is manthano, which means disciple. So Epaphras hadn't only told people about the gospel, hadn't only said with his mouth, the gospel is about that Jesus has come and has died for our sins, and God raised him from the dead, and if we believe in him, we can come into full forgiveness and freedom. That's the gospel. He didn't only say it, he lived it. And that's important, isn't it? We receive more communication non-verbally than we do verbally. And if we are known as people of the gospel, we need to live the gospel. And Epaphras was somebody who did live the gospel. And Paul wrote this letter to the Colossians, and in chapter 1 we hear that Paul had heard from Epaphras, firstly, good news. What was the good news that Paul had heard about the church in Epaphras? What would be the good news that somebody could say about the church here in Matson? Well, the good news that Epaphras shared with Paul was about their love in the Spirit. There was no other explanation for how, in a class-divided society, you could get a group of people coming together as equals. And people who were officers and lords sitting alongside people who were servants as equals. Not only demonstrating by the way they came together and were all one, but that if somebody was in need, they helped each other out materially, emotionally, supporting each other. That was the good news that Paul had been told about the church in Colossae. But there was some bad news too. People were teaching the wrong stuff. People were putting the emphasis on this new church on things that weren't the central point. Minoring on minors, majoring on minors, instead of majoring on the major stuff. And what they were emphasizing, or what they'd created, was a mixture of pagan and Jewish religion. So they were talking about angel worship. They were talking about secret knowledge. I know something. Do you want to know it? It's only for you and me. It's not for everybody. We're a special little group, and we've got this secret knowledge. And they were emphasizing high days and holidays and laws about food and drink. And all of that was shifting the focus from being about Jesus Christ to minor things that were being made too important. And the letter to the Colossians rectifies that. His letter emphasizes the supremacy and the importance of Jesus. So here, That brings us to these verses from Colossians chapter 4, and I'll read them again. Greetings from Epaphras, another member of your group, and a servant of Christ Jesus. He always prays fervently for you, asking God to make you stand firm as mature and fully convinced Christians. That was the burden of his prayer. In complete obedience to God's will, I can personally testify to his hard work for you and for the people in Laodicea and Hierapolis. He always prays fervently for you. He wrestles, he labors, he struggles in prayer. The Greek word is agonizomos, I think. No, it isn't. It's agonizomonos. What word do you think comes from that? Agonizomonos. Agony, absolutely. And what we think of when we think of agonizing in prayer? The Garden of Gethsemane and Jesus agonizing in prayer. Lord, take this cup from me. Jesus was going to the cross and he's pouring out his heart in prayer. Desperate pleas. And the stress becomes so much that Luke in his gospel says that he sweat drops of blood from his forehead. That was once seen in World War I, when soldiers in the trenches were under so much stress that the capillaries would break in their forehead and drops of blood would appear, and they knew that if that happened to any serving soldier, he'd be dead within a matter of hours. I'm not going to say any more about that because Sam's preaching on the subject. And if I went on about it, he might think that I'm stealing his thunder. I don't want to do that. Hopefully that's a good introduction, Sam, for your sermon coming down the way. Jesus went from the agony of his prayer to the agony of the cross for you and for me, for our freedom, that we might live in the good of his death for us and know the freedom of the being children of God. What did he pray for with his agonizing prayers? He was asking God to make the people in Colossae, who are part of that church, he wanted them to stand firm, mature, and fully convinced Christians in complete obedience to God's will. Epaphras didn't want the young church, the new church, that was all comprised of people that he knew, part of his community, he didn't want them to be like waves of the sea tossed around by the wind, as we read of in the book of James. He wanted them to be people with a whole faith, a fully rounded, consistent life. Not people for whom their Christian bit was reserved to one part of their life or one time in the week. He wanted their whole of their life to be permeated by their new found belief and faith in the Lord Jesus. He prays for a strong faith that will be strong enough to withstand the inevitable knocks and the inevitable suffering that would come to a church in the Roman Empire with Roman authorities who looked upon them as subversive and dangerous people. And he prays that they will be saved from an adulterated belief that denies the glorious and saving truth of the gospel, the amazing grace. And if they'd listened to false teachers who'd started to teach other things and got distracted and taken up with things that took them away from focusing on Jesus, that would not be the direction to go in that would mean that they would be standing firm, fully convinced as Christians. He wanted them to stay true to Jesus and who Jesus is. A couple of reflections on that. Spiritual maturity is not instant. It's not automatic. It's gradual, progressive development that will take the rest of your life. There's no ticking the box and say, well, I've arrived, I've got there. I know all that I need to know. God's done all that he needs to do in my life. He's knocked off all the chips. He's rounded me up. I'm a complete person now. Is there? No, it's a lifelong journey. So Epaphras' prayer was for something that should be in all of our lives, for all of our lives, growing, developing, understanding, learning more. God still working in us and through us. Another reflection is that we're engaged in a spiritual battle, a battle against principalities and powers in the heavenly places. I think sometimes we need a greater awareness of that. And I think sometimes even for ourselves and for our own church, we need to be casting our spiritual eyes over our people and over our place. We need to be circumspect. We need to be praying for God's protection over potential pitfalls of ours or others that we care for. And for the church in Colossae, Epaphras was battling. They were facing threats that went to the heart of our faith, that true freedom is found in Christ. And if you lose that and begin to trust in following certain laws or being party to secret knowledge, you look away from trusting in Christ. And that is a dangerous place to be. So Epaphras agonized in prayer for these people, his people in the church, just as Jesus agonized in prayer before he faced the agony of the cross. So faithful ministry is born at the cross. Being a follower of Jesus is about taking up our cross and following him. That's what Jesus said. If you want to come after me, take up your cross and follow me. What was Jesus' cross for him? He came to be the pain bearer for our broken world. And he says that if we're following him, we too are going to be pain bearers for our broken world. And that sometimes, maybe not sometimes, that in its essence is going to mean followers of Jesus choosing to identify with other people's pain, other people's predicament, other people's suffering, and sitting alongside them in that place, choosing to do it. That's what Jesus did for us. He was our pain bearer at the cross. And he says if we're following him, we'll do the same thing. We will be a pain bearer for others. It'll be something that we do because we are a follower of Jesus. I learned something from the years that we spent in Pakistan about that. And it was the Pakistani culture way of afsos karna, which is to do sorrow. We were missionaries in Pakistan for 10 years. We did agricultural development work and we lived in the villages, in the community of the people. And if somebody died, you would do sorrow. And that meant that you would just go and sit with them. And if there'd been a death in the family, that they'd be welcoming people in their home and they would all sit around, the men in one area and the women in another area, and you just sat with them. To identify with where they were at. To share their sorrow. You see that in the book of Ezekiel. When God calls the prophet Ezekiel, before he's able to go as God's messenger to that people, God picks him up and puts him down, and for 7 days he sat where they were sitting. And the importance for that is that if we're going to communicate, if we're going to be messengers of God to whoever it is, firstly, we've got to sit where they're sitting. Now, Epaphras was somebody who did that. He was with Paul in prison or under house arrest or whatever, but he prayed for the church back in Colossae, and not just quick, flippant prayers. He entered into hard work in prayer for the church in Colossae. He agonized in prayer for them, praying that God would protect them from the false teaching, keep them true to himself. And that was a battle that he was engaged in, and Paul testified to the fact that he was working hard for his own people. So just what does that share about prayer? In all that you've been learning and reflecting about prayer, sometimes prayer is struggle. Sometimes prayer is wrestling. Sometimes prayer does involve agonizing. And it is certainly hard work. As Paul says, I can personally testify to his hard work for you and for the people in Laodicea and Hierapolis. So, and I also think there's a sort of a balance we need to carry in our hearts. One, it is a battle. And in Ephesians chapter 6, where Paul describes the armor, he finishes that passage off with, and pray, and all circumstances, pray, and cover everything in prayer, as if that's the ultimate armor that we need to have in the spiritual battle that we are engaged with. At the same time, Jesus says to us, come to me, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, and find rest in your souls. So the burden that we take up is not a burden to drag us down, because it's a burden that we can carry, sustained by the strength and the help of God to do his work. There we are. That's where I'm going to finish. May God help you and me as we learn about prayer from these verses. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that from Paul's comments at the end of his letter, we can learn significant things. And thank you for what we can learn about Epaphras and how he prayed for his people back in the church in Colossae. We pray that you'd help us to learn from that. We pray that you will bless us as we pray. Help us to understand that prayer can be part of the battle that we are engaged in our world, as we seek to be light in darkness, and as we seek to be your people and doing the good works that you have prepared in advance for us to do. May that include prayer and praying sincerely and persistently for the things that you lay on our hearts, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Mahaba means hello. Assalamu alaikum means peace be upon you. And had I given you warning, you would have replied, wa alaikum assalam, and peace be upon you too. Sylvia asked me to talk to you about the reflection that was in the World Day of Prayer. But before that, before what I prepared, there is a poem in the World Day of Prayer book, Pray Together, that I read and was going to include in my reflection, but discounted it as adding to the time. But with what Rupert said, I am going to include it. This was written by Elizabeth Burroughs, who was, until recently, was the chairman of World Day of Prayer. An ecumenical accompanier in East Jerusalem. I'm sorry, I can't offer you coffee. My house has just been demolished. We stand together, family and supporter, accompanied and accompanier. The bulldozer drives away. The soldiers depart, laughing and joking, leaving a pile of rubble, a storehouse of shattered memories, here and there remembered objects, a black T-shirt, an embroidered cushion, a Barbra Streisand CD. They gave us 10 minutes to retrieve what we treasure most, the toys, the photographs, the keepsakes. We shall rebuild the house, inshallah. But some things we can never replace. And why? What did we do to harm them? Why does the world allow them to hurt us so? We do not hate the Israeli people. We do not understand them. All we want is peace, but peace with justice. I cannot answer their questions. I can do nothing but stand with them, hold them, weep with them. We stand together, family and supporter, accompanied and accompanier. I'm sorry, I cannot offer you coffee. My house has just been demolished. Now, those people who know anything about the Arab peoples will know that they're very well known for their hospitality. It's impossible to visit a Palestinian house without being invited to have coffee or mint tea, and it is most impolite to refuse. So I felt I just had to include that poem because it fitted in so well with what you said about sharing our sorrows. Now I will go on to what I have prepared. I've just mentioned World Day of Prayer, and as most of you know, that just 10 days ago, Matson Baptist hosted the World Day of Prayer on the first of the month. It was a very moving service written by the Christian women of Palestine, who at the time had no idea that when years after its conception, so used to they are the constant conflict and restrictions by the Israelis, that they would find themselves again bombed out of their homeland. At the end of the service that day, many people came to me and expressed their appreciation. And I'm sure all were left with the feeling that peace must come and that the prayers of the world during that one day would surely help all people suffering such terrible conflicts. One of the hymns sung that day was written by Fred Kahn. Put peace into each other's hands. I didn't know anything about Fred Kahn. Perhaps some of you do, but was moved enough to find out. I found out that he had died in 2009, aged 80. He was born in 1929 in Haarlem in the Netherlands and was a teenager at the time of the Nazi occupation. His parents were deeply involved in the resistance movement, and three of his grandparents died of starvation during that time. As he grew, he became a pacifist and began to study theology. He accepted a place at Western College, Bristol. Then, in 1955, was ordained at the Congregational into the Congregational Ministry. His life's work as a minister began in Barry, South Wales, and I was near there yesterday. He did more than just learn English. He taught himself to lose all trace of his Dutch accent, and I'm sure he learned Welsh too. Didn't say that in the information I had. He was a person of wide sympathies with a warm and cheeky humour. He held many major posts throughout his ministry, but found time to write poetry and hymns for the healing of the nations, being one that we know well. Also taken from the World Day of Prayer service, using the first lines of Fred's hymn, Elaine Barnett has written this piece for us to reflect upon now, and I shall never tire of reading it. So please bear with me. Put peace into each other's hands. Put peace into each other's hands, and like a treasure hold it. Put peace into each other's hands. Put peace. It requires action, Lord, prayerful action. Not just hoping for something, yearning for something, even praying for something, but actively doing something. And put peace into each other's hand, Lord. But what about my viewpoint and opinion? Because to put something into someone else's hands means giving it away, not holding on to what is mine, letting go. It might be a bit easier if I knew I would be giving it to those I know and love, those I trust. But what about the other? Those who are different from me, those I don't agree with, those I'm not sure I can trust. My thoughts, viewpoints, hopes, prayers, given away. And as I stand, momentarily empty-handed, how do I feel? There is a vulnerability in giving, offering peace? Will it be rebuffed, mocked, or accepted? Welcomed? Put peace into each other's hands, and like a treasure, hold it. Like a treasure, hold it. A reminder, Lord, that this is something precious. This gift of peace we give to each other. Having given it, how can I now recognize its worth? Can I treasure it? Indeed, can I even accept it? That's not so strange a question as it may seem. Because again, it would be easier from those I know and love, those I trust. But can I receive from the other? Those who are different from me, those I don't agree with, those I'm not sure I can trust. Surely one of the most significant parts of the parable of the Good Samaritan lies in the wounded traveller accepting help, care and provision from one of the Samaritans who was so despised. Very definitely the other, the different, the I don't agree with them, oh, I never trusted them. Giving and receiving peace requires generosity of spirit, openness and trust, as well as the humility to accept. It's a precious thing then. Lord, grant us grace to put peace into each other's hands, and like a treasure, hold it. Amen.
Let's now bow our heads and say prayers of intercession. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this fellowship here at Matson. You know each one individually. You know their needs. You know their concerns. We pray, Lord, for those who are struggling due to health issues and for their loved ones supporting them. For those who are finding it hard to make ends meet, for those who are seeking employment or a change of job, for those who are worried because of difficult family issues. In all of these, Lord, we pray that they will have a strength and a peace that comes only from knowing and trusting in you. Remind us, Lord, that in all things you work for the good of those who love you. And as a fellowship, help us to support one another in whatever way we can, both spiritually and practically. And Lord, now we pray for our city. Like most cities in this country, Gloucester has its fair share of problems. Knife crime, drugs, alcohol issues, etc. We pray for those organisations trying to help all those struggling in life. We pray for the debt counsellors, the food banks, those who work in the care sector, our NHS, and the organisations like GDAS who help those who have addictions. We pray for the leaders of the Gloucester City Council. We ask that they show wisdom in the decisions they regularly have to make for our city. Lord, we thank you for the Christian churches in Gloucester and for their witness as they reach out to their local communities. And we pray for the leaders that you have put in place as they shepherd their flock. Now, Lord, we bring our country before you. We would ask that the leaders of our government display integrity and honesty in all that they say and all that they do. We also bring the monarchy before you and pray for the health and well-being of our king and also his daughter-in-law, Kate. Lastly, we lay before you the problems of the world as a whole. Lord, there are so many wars taking place at the moment, and so many innocent people affected. Ukraine, Russia, Israel, and Gaza, the violence in Haiti, and the troubles around the Red Sea, and there's far more. We pray that you will bless the peacemakers trying to bring about peace in such difficult situations. Lord, we are a broken world and a fallen people. Our ways are often foolish, our motives wrong. Whereas your ways are higher than our ways. And yet, you love the world so much that you gave your one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. We pray, Lord, that more and more people will experience this love and realize that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. In his precious name, amen.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Sue. Thank you, Rupert. Lots and lots to think about. Just a few notices. Thank you all, those who prayed and fasted on Thursday when we were trying to get possession of the manse. It was successful, and hopefully things will be positive. So thank you for that. Thank you for your contributions. Hi. Next Sunday, we've got communion and the service is being led by Marion and Sam. The deacons meeting this coming Thursday, if you could pray for the deacons. Church meeting on the 23rd, Saturday 23rd at 10 o'clock. And just one more request. St. Catherine's on the Hill wanted to join with us on Easter Saturday to do a messy church, but it's really volunteers. I can see two volunteers over there now who've just arrived back. If you're interested, that's the twins I'm talking to. If anybody, messy church is right up their street. They're so arty, crafty. But if they're around, that would be great. So come and see me if you're able to do that. Any volunteers for Easter Saturday, 10 o'clock, for 2 hours? Thank you very much. Thank you.
Right, before we give you a bit of work to do, do you want to show us what you've been doing today?
Yeah, come on then.
Come and tell us what you've been doing.
They've made some pictures for their mums, which have got a verse on, and they've decorated a little book for their mum as well. We've been thinking about how special mums are and how much they do for us and how we've got to say thank you to God for them.
Lovely. Right, we're going to put them to work now then. So Sue's going to supervise and every lady will get a flower. So come on then, guys, you're going to help out and invite them.
For the knowing that you're not alone. For the darling, don't you dare give up.
I think Sue deserves a big clap for getting all those flowers. Thank you, Sue. May the grace of God uphold you, the peace of God surround you, the love of God flow from you, and the strength of God protect and bring you safely through this day. Amen.
Amen.